Tonight's keynote speaker, Ron Dermer, also has a vision for Israel's future, one that is shaped by a keen understanding of her history, interests, technological strengths, and partnership with Arab countries. As Israel's ambassador to the United States from 2013 until January of this year, Ron was a key player behind the Abraham Accords that were signed in August of last year. Born and raised in Miami Beach, he earned degrees from the Wharton School of Business and Oxford University before serving as a columnist for the Jerusalem Post, and in 2004 co-authored with Natan Sharansky the best-selling book, The Case for Democracy, The Power of Freedom to Overcome Tyranny and Terror, which has been translated into 10 languages. Ron will be interviewed by Ambassador Jonathan Peleg in Jerusalem, where they both live. While Ron served in Washington, Jonathan represented Israel on the other side of the border as Israel's ambassador to Mexico and prior to that, El Salvador. As one of Israel's most experienced diplomats, he previously served as spokesman for the Foreign Ministry and Washington Embassy and policy advisor to Foreign Minister Peres, and a peace negotiator following the Oslo Accords. We first got to know Jonathan earlier this year when he served in Australia as Israel's interim ambassador, and he has become a good friend. Welcome, Ambassadors Ron Dermer and Jonathan Peleg, as we now cross to Jerusalem. Thank you.
Thank you, Dan, and shalom to all. It's a great pleasure to be here with a friend and former colleague, Ambassador Ron Dermer, on this special occasion of the 120th anniversary of JNF. And I'm sure many of us have a recollection and a childhood memory of the pushke, the blue tin box. And I'd like to start off really by asking Ron, what is your recollection? What has your relationship been with JNF over these years?
First, it's great to be with you, Jonathan, and it's a real pleasure to speak for JNF Australia, because I know the contribution they've made to the JNF for so long. I think the highest per capita contribution of any Jewish community in the world, any JNF office in the world, but I think also second in absolute terms to the United States, which I think is a credit to the strong Jewish community in Australia. My connection with the JNF actually goes back to the time I was born, because when I was born, my father was the president of JNF in Miami at that time. So we were always connected to it, and I remember that pushka growing up. And one of the gifts that made the final cut, you know, when you're ambassador, and I was ambassador for 7.5 years in Washington, so you get a lot of people who give you a lot of things. And then at the end, you're saying, what are the things that are most meaningful to you that, you know, are you going to display in your office? And one of the things that I really cherish was a gift that I got from JNF. It's an encased in glass, one of those pushkas. And I take it with me because I think it tells a remarkable story about Israel and the contribution that Jews across the world made to Israel. And the founder of modern Zionism, as you know, political Zionism, Theodor Herzl, envisioned the Jewish state in the 1890s. And when he envisioned that state, he understood you're going to need foundations. You're going to have to establish organizations and structures and institutions that are going to be able to build that state. And one of the most important of them was the JNF, that allowed Israel to come and reclaim the land, Jewish people to reclaim the land, and to bring this vision of Herzl into a reality. And JNF has been a partner of that from the beginning, and they are a partner today, 120 years later, in particular in translating a new vision into reality. It's an old new vision because it was a vision of David Ben-Gurion, going the founder of politically of the State of Israel, the first prime minister of Israel, who understood and believed strongly that the future of Israel and the test of Israel will be, are we going to be able to develop the Negev? And here we are over 70 years later, and the Negev still hasn't developed the way that it should. And you have 60% of the territory of the country in the Negev and only about 8% of our population. So it's very important to be able to develop it strategically for security, for the future economy and thriving of the State of Israel. And I think JNF, in particular, JNF Australia, is really leading the way at making that desert bloom and taking an old new vision and turning it into a reality.
You were very fortunate to be in Washington during those years, and during the last year, actually, and being part of behind the scenes. Can you share with us a bit of what was going on with the Trump administration behind the scenes? Was there a moment where it was do or die, or sort of it would be exposed, or it would sort of on the brink of failure. Sort of what can you tell us a bit about how all this came about?
Well, I'll tell you, first take a step back. Before the Trump administration comes in, we had recognized, and we actually had tried to convince the previous administration of this as well, the Obama administration, that there was a change throughout the region in the Middle East, and a change in the views of many Arab states. And that change was driven by a number of factors. First was the rise of Iran as a power. You know, the silver lining in the very dark cloud of the nuclear deal with Iran was that it brought Israel and the Arab states together because they feared that this deal was going to really empower Iran, because all the sanctions would be removed, all the money would flow into its coffers, and they would be able to continue their campaign of carnage and conquest throughout the region. So the rise of Iran was on the minds of these Arab leaders. The second thing that was on their minds is the dangers that come from Sunni fanaticism. Iran is a Shia power, and it's a radical one. Shia historically have actually been much more moderate in the Arab world. But you also have a Sunni side of the equation. Al-Qaeda was 1.0, ISIS is 2.0, and there'll be a 3.0. And so those Arab regimes are seeing a Shia fanaticism and a Sunni fanaticism. How are we going to deal with this in the decades ahead? And the third element, which is critical, which I think a lot of people don't pay that much attention to, you know it as a diplomat, is the perception, which is not false, that the United States is leaving the region and is certainly reducing its military footprint. And that links, it links President Obama with President Trump and now President Biden, because no one is looking to put more troops in the Middle East. And so if you think about it from the point of view of the Arab states, what they see is an Iranian tiger and an ISIS leopard or whatever comes next, and they see an 800-pound American gorilla is leaving the building. So they look around and they say, here's a 250-pound gorilla with a keep on. Maybe we'll work with them. So their fundamental security interests argue for strengthening the alliance with Israel and to find a way to normalize ties. The second thing that's important is Israeli technology. Israel is a global technology power. And if you think about it, the traditional Arab boycott of Israel is about as smart as Oregon, Nevada, Utah, Wyoming, Colorado, New Mexico, Arizona, and half of southern half of California boycotting Silicon Valley. It makes no sense. So to the extent that you have leaders in the Arab world who want to advance their country's security, as I mentioned, and also prosperity, Israel is the best partner that they could possibly have. This all happened. This dynamic was there before
Trump
came in. And we tried actually in the early months of the weeks actually of the Trump administration to convince them of this possibility. But there were some naysayers. There are some people who thought, no, that's not going to happen. Or, you know, maybe Israel's saying it because they're not prepared to make certain concessions regarding the Palestinians. And it took a while, I think, for recognition to dawn on the people in the Trump administration that this was really something that was possible. And I give them great credit for being open-minded enough to see the reality as it is, not as they hoped it to be. And people like Jared Kushner, and there was Jason Greenblatt and Avi Berkowitz and others in the Trump administration understood this is real. You know, what Israel has been telling us is real. And the Arabs are actually willing to move into alliance. And then we got stuck, by the way, in about a year of this political loop, because I believe that after the first 2 years, we were ready to have this breakthrough, and then we got stuck in one election after another election after election. We kind of wasted a year, a very important year. I don't know.
The election in Israel, of course. For
election cycles in Israel, because it's very hard to actually put things out in the middle of an election for many, many different reasons and to craft a policy. And so it was frustrating to have one election after another. And I know it was frustrating for Netanyahu as well, because we were rearing to go. The United States understood the opportunity, and here we hopefully could surface it. The problem of how to surface it is you have Arab partners who want it to be surfaced. You, of course, want to surface. The United States wants to surface. One of the issues we had was they've been poisoning their populations for 70 years against Israel, and they've claimed that everything is about the Israeli-Palestinian conflict, which it never was. But how do they get out of that problem? And so one thing you have to do is shift U.S. policy. And that's what I tried to do also as ambassador. And thankfully, there were great partners in the U.S. administration for doing it. So you have this situation where the Arabs are ready. Now you have to create the political dynamics to be able to surface it. And one way we did that was U.S. policy shifted from appeasing Iran to confronting Iran, which for them, if you think about it, for the Arab leaders, it gives them more political space to move to an alliance with Israel. Because when that Abraham Accord ceremony happened in September of 2020, the people in the region, the people in the Emirates, the people in Bahrain, the people in Saudi Arabia, who do they see standing at the White House? When they see Trump and Netanyahu, it's not just the political personalities. They see two people who are confronting their biggest enemy, which is Iran. So that creates more space for them to move in. The second thing that happened was the Trump administration's support for Israel was tremendous. You saw it in Jerusalem. You saw it in the Golan Heights. You saw it in even Judea, Samaria, and many other controversial issues where the Trump administration really, really was supporting Israel. And the message that sent to the Arab states was that a way for them to get closer to Washington was to move closer to Jerusalem. So in addition to confronting Iran and embracing Israel, there was a third issue, and that was how to deal with the whole Palestinian question. And the problem is, for a long time, people have effectively given President Abbas and Arafat before him veto power over progress in the Middle East. That the idea was that the road to peace has to go through Ramallah. And that would be great if the Palestinians were interested in making peace with us. And I used to get asked all the time and told a lot of times by American officials of both Republican and Democratic administrations, you know, if you make peace with the Palestinians, you'll have peace with 22 Arab states. And I said, well, great. Well, what if they don't want to make peace with us? Are we going to wait? Why can't we have that peace with the Arab states now? Why do we have to wait for them to cross this psychological Rubicon, which unfortunately the Palestinian leadership has not crossed, which is to recognize the legitimacy of the Jewish state, not just the might of Israel, but the right of Israel to live in this region. And what the administration did was they left the door open for the Palestinians, should they choose to enter, but they didn't give them the veto power. So those three things together, confronting Iran, embracing Israel, and leaving a door open but not giving them veto power, that set the stage for what we were able to achieve with the Abraham Accords. President Trump's and his team launched their peace proposal, if you remember, in January of 2020. There were three ambassadors who were in the room at the time. Very few journalists really did their job and focused on it, because it was the Emirati ambassador, it was the Bahraini ambassador, and it was the Omani ambassador. So we made peace later that year with two of the three. Now, we don't have formal diplomatic relations with them, but here we made peace with them. And with Oman, the Sultan died. I think had the Sultan not died, we probably would have had a third peace agreement. And we also ultimately made peace with Morocco and made peace with Sudan as well. But what we tried to do in launching the peace proposal is, again, to tell the Palestinians, because they've rejected every single peace plan for a century, here's an opportunity. We hope you take it. But the Arab states who for their own interests, which I mentioned, the security interests and the technology interests, who want to move forward with Israel, they can point to that plan and tell the Palestinians, guys, if you have issues, get into negotiations with Israel. But in the meantime, we're going to move forward for our own interests. And that's really what happened several months later, as the Emirati leadership came to the Americans, who then came to me, and of course I conveyed it to the Prime Minister, that they were actually prepared to normalize relations with Israel. And there was a move at that point, if you recall, to go and apply Israeli law to parts of the Trump plan that would be in Israel in the future. And the Emiratis had come to the United States and said, you know, if they don't go forward now with that part of the plan, we are willing today to normalize with Israel. And once I got that message, I conveyed it to the Prime Minister. He understood this was in the interest of the state of Israel. And I think it has made a big difference to Israel. But we worked for about 6 weeks. I worked with the White House and with Yusuf Aloteba, who was in contact with them constantly. We worked for about 6 weeks to craft the language that we needed to sort of launch this peace. And I think it's tremendous for Israel, because it's different than what happened with Egypt and what happened with Jordan. You know, we are blessed to have peace with Egypt for over 40 years, and we're blessed to have peace with Jordan for over 25 years. But those two peace agreements, they resulted in a cold peace, not in a warm peace. And a cold peace is definitely better than a hot war, but you'd like to actually see a warm peace. And I think the reason is there are many cultural, political, economic forces within Egypt and Jordan that are constantly militating against peace. You do not see that in the Emirates. You do not see that in Bahrain. Here you have a people, and it might be because we have a different history with them. They don't have a common border. We haven't fought wars. There's many reasons, but the fact is that what I see is the encouragement of this peace from the business sector within the Emirates and certainly within Bahrain, but many other sectors of society that are moving this peace forward, not only from the top down, and there's no question that Mohammed bin Zayed, the leader, the sheikh, the crown prince of the Emirates, was a key figure in this whole process of moving forward. So he's pushing it from the top, and the people are pushing it from the bottom,
people to people.
And so I'm really grateful for the Jewish community in Australia that I know is one of the strongest and proudest Jewish communities in the world, for everything they have done for Israel in the past and for everything they're going to do for Israel in the future.
I fully agree. And really, thank you very much, Ambassador Ron Dermer, for joining us. I hope this is not instead of visiting Australia. I take upon myself, on behalf of JNF and the Australian Jewish community, to extend an invitation, and hopefully you can come and visit Australia very soon. Thank you very, very much, and I wish you all the best in your future endeavors.